All right. Well, welcome everyone tonight to our Good Friday service. Good looking group out there. Thank y'all so much for coming tonight. Before we begin, I do want to give a couple announcements. Remember, tomorrow is our Easter egg hunt. And so come hang out and meet people from the community. And then Miss Pat reminded me to, if we can wear to wear our church shirts so they can know, hey, if they have a question, they can ask and things like that. But I think there was another announcement. Now it's escaping me. But anyway, again, just really, really glad. We have a special program tonight, and I hope that you will be blessed by it. So let's now come to our call to worship. And we're going to be in Isaiah chapter 52, verses 13 through Isaiah 53, verse 12. And this text was written hundreds of years, around 700 years or so before Christ stepped on this earth. And it's just an amazing passage from the Old Testament telling us what Jesus is going to do. So let's all stand now as we read God's Word. This is the Word of the Lord. Behold, my servant shall act wisely. He shall be high and lifted up, and shall be exalted. As many were astonished at you, his appearance was so marred beyond human semblance, and his form beyond that of the children of mankind. So shall he sprinkle many nations. Kings shall shut their mouths because of him, for that which has not been told them they see, and that which they have not heard they understand. Who has believed what he has heard from us? And to whom has the arm of the Lord been revealed? For he grew up before him like a young plant, and like a root out of dry ground. He had no form or majesty that we should look at him, and no beauty that we should desire him. He was despised and rejected by men, a man of sorrows and acquainted with grief, and as one from whom men hide their faces. He was despised, and we esteemed him not. Surely he has borne our griefs and carried our sorrows, yet we esteemed him stricken, smitten by God, and afflicted. But he was pierced for our transgressions. He was crushed for our iniquities. Upon him was the chastisement that brought us peace, and with his wounds we are healed. Think about that. All we like sheep have gone astray. We have turned everyone to his own way, and the Lord has laid on him the iniquity of us all. He was oppressed and he was afflicted, yet he opened not his mouth. Like a lamb that is led to the slaughter, and like a sheep that before its shearers is silent, so he opened not his mouth. By oppression and judgment he was taken away. And as for his generation, who considered that he was cut off out of the land of the living, stricken for the transgression of my people? And they made his grave with the wicked, and with a rich man in his death, although he had done no violence, and there was no deceit in his mouth. Yet it was the will of the Lord to crush him. He has put him to grief. When his soul makes an offering for guilt, he shall see his offspring. He shall prolong his days. The will of the Lord shall prosper in his hand. Out of the anguish of his soul, he shall see and be satisfied. By his knowledge shall the righteous one, my servant, make many to be accounted righteous, and he shall bear their iniquities. Therefore, I will divide him a portion with the many, and he shall divide the spoil with the strong, because he poured out his soul to death and was numbered with the transgressors. Yet he bore the sin of many and makes intercession for the transgressors. Oh, amen. Let's pray. Lord God, thank you for this Good Friday evening. Thank you for these saints who have come here tonight to think about, remember, and even celebrate the death of Christ that has given us redemption and forgiveness of sins. So, Lord God, may we put away distractions right now. Brothers and sisters, right now, just repent of sin. Prepare your hearts for the Lord's Supper. And know that God is faithful and just to forgive us our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. God, thank you for this church. May our service be pleasing to you and bring you glory. We love you and we praise you. In Jesus' name, amen, amen. All right, let's all remain standing for our first song. Brother Ronnie?
He is Lord. He is Lord, He is Lord. He is risen from the dead and He is Lord. Every knee shall bow, every tongue confess that Jesus Christ is Lord. He is Lord, He is Lord. He is risen from the dead and He is Lord. Every knee shall bow, every tongue confess that Jesus Christ is Lord. Every knee shall bow, every tongue confess that Jesus Christ is Lord. Amen. Jeff? Y'all may be seated.
Walking on the road to Jerusalem, the time had come to sacrifice again. My two small sons, they walked beside me on the road. Reason that they came was to watch the Lamb. Daddy, Daddy, what will we see there? There's so much that we don't understand. So I told them of Moses and Father Abraham. And then I said, dear children, watch the Lamb. There will be so many in Jerusalem today. We must be sure the Lamb doesn't run away. And I told them of Moses and Father Abraham. And then I said, dear children, watch the Lamb. When we reached the city, I knew something must be wrong. There were no joyful worshipers, no joyful worship songs. I stood there with my children in the midst of angry men. Crowd cry out, said, even now they come. The first one cried for mercy, the people gave him none. The second one was violent, he was arrogant and loud. I still can hear his angry voice screaming at the crowd. Then someone said, there's Jesus, and I scarce believed my eyes. A man so badly beaten, he barely looked alive. Blood poured from his body, from the thorns upon his brow, running down the cross and falling to the ground. I watched him as he struggled. I watched him as he fell. The cross came down upon his back. The crowd began to yell. In that moment, I felt such agony. In that moment, I felt such loss. Until a Roman soldier grabbed my arm and screamed, you carry his cross. At first, I tried to resist him. And then his hand reached for his sword. And so I knelt and took the cross from the Lord. I placed it on my shoulder and started down the street. The blood that he'd been shedding was running down my cheek. They led us to Golgotha. They drove nails deep in his feet and hands. Yet upon the cross, I heard him pray, Father, forgive them. Oh, never have I seen such love in any other eye. Into thy hands I commit my spirit. He prayed and then he died. I stood for what seemed like years. I'd lost all sense of time until I felt two tiny hands holding tight to mine. My children stood there weeping. I heard the oldest say, Father, please forgive us. The lamb ran away. Daddy, Daddy, what have we seen here? There's so much that we don't understand. So I took them in my arms. We turned and faced the cross. Then I said, dear children, watch the Lamb.
Let's sing, Jesus Paid It All.
I hear the Savior say,
Thy strength indeed is small, child of weakness, watch and pray. Find in me thine all in all. Jesus paid it all to him I owe. Sin had left a crimson stain, he washed it white as snow. Lord, now indeed I find thy power in thine alone can change the leper's spots and melt the heart of stone. Jesus paid it all to him I owe. Sin had left a crimson stain, he washed it white as snow. For nothing good have I, whereby thy grace to claim. Yeah, wash my garments white in the blood of Calvary's Lamb. Jesus paid it all to him I owe. Sin had left a crimson stain, he washed it white as snow. And when before the throne I stand in him complete, Jesus died my soul to save, my lips will still repeat, Jesus paid it all to him I owe. Sin had left a crimson stain, he washed it white as snow. Hopes and dreams completely crumbled. My life was built on sinking sand, bowed beneath the weight of sorrow, till I was touched by wounds. Wounded hands of the Savior gently took this shattered heart. Every broken piece was mended by the hands that held the scar. Darkness held the cross of suffering, where grace would answer sin's demands. My account the saddle. The price was paid. My wounded hand. Wounded hands of the Savior gently took this shattered.
Great to be with you this evening. My name is Rusty. I have the privilege of serving as the senior pastor in the Northern Kingdom of Buna over at Central Baptist Church. And man, I'm just delighted to be with you. I really appreciate Brother Randy inviting me to be a part of this special service tonight. My family and I were glad to get to come over and worship alongside you guys. Randy and I were talking about it before the service started, and our wives were making fun of us because we can't even figure out when we became friends. We're not even sure how, but in the Lord's providence, I'm very grateful for Brother Randy and his friendship. We have been friends. I've pastored here locally in Koontz, and then the Lord called our family to Wichita, Kansas for a season. So I've been to the northern kingdom for a season, and now the Lord has graciously called us back here about 6 months ago. So one of the reasons I was excited is right about the same time we kind of both back ended up in this area, and it's just good to be able to be right down the road from friends. To be honest with you, though, I did not realize that we were this close to Orange. That's what I told Randy the first time I talked to him. He's like, we got to do lunch sometime. And I'm like, yeah, maybe if I'm down in that area. He's like, you realize you're like 30 minutes from Archer? So I didn't even know. So now I do. And I'm glad to know you guys and excited to spend a little time with you in God's Word. I want to direct our attention together to Romans chapter 3. Several years ago, when my oldest daughter, who's 10 now, was in first or second grade, we actually attended a Good Friday service at another friend's church there in the Wichita area. And it was one of those services that had some dramatic elements. So they actually had somebody portraying Christ being nailed to a cross, and then they actually took him off of the cross and laid him on a table in a tomb and sealed him up. And we left that way. We know on this side of the cross what's coming, praise the Lord. But I remember that drive back to the house. She asked a question that I think is worthy of consideration tonight. She said, Daddy, why did Jesus die on the cross? Now, lucky for her, she had a very wise theologian driving the car that she was in. So I answered the question the way that perhaps you would answer it this evening. Well, Jesus died on the cross to pay the price for our sins. And being the very probing first or second grader she was, she continued to press and asked, but why did he have to die on the cross to do that? Over the years, I've appreciated the honesty not only of a child's question, but I've had people young and old ask similar questions. Well, couldn't the Lord have just forgiven sin? Why did the Son have to die, and why is this the way that it happened? Perhaps on this Good Friday, you're asking yourself a similar question. Maybe you're wondering, why is it this way? Well, the good news is the Bible tells us clearly in a beautiful and compelling way why this horrific death is actually the source of beauty and hope for those of us who are in Christ and for those who would ultimately come to Him. So I want to read this text together, starting in verse 21 of Romans chapter 3, and we'll read verses 21 through 26. So let's read this together. But now the righteousness of God has been manifested apart from the law, although the law and the prophets bear witness to it. The righteousness of God through faith in Jesus Christ for all who believe. There is no distinction, for all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God, and are justified by His grace as a gift through the redemption that is in Christ Jesus, whom God put forward as a propitiation by His blood to be received by faith. This was to show God's righteousness, because in His divine forbearance He had passed over former sins. It was to show His righteousness at the present time, so that He might be just and the justifier of the one who has faith in Jesus. Let's pray and ask the Lord to help us as we study His Word. Father, we do ask that You would help us as we seek to dive into Your Word, that You would give us clarity, that You would help us see the beautiful reality of what it is we're reflecting upon this Good Friday. Lord, thank You for Your gospel. May we know it more fully. May we grasp it, and Lord, not only know it, but live it and experience it this evening. We love You, Lord. It's in Your name we pray. Amen. Well, the book of Romans, of course, is Paul's magnum opus. This is his great work. This is his masterclass of gospel theology. He had never made it to Rome at this point and wasn't really sure if he was going to. So because of that uncertainty, I really feel like he just thought, man, I may never make it there to have time to... Geez, so this letter has all of his thoughts on the gospel, and it is a masterclass in gospel theology. He wants to just saturate them in the truth of Jesus' death, burial, and resurrection, and how that transforms our lives. And what Paul really works to do in the first three chapters of Romans is this difficult work of introducing us to the problem of humanity. The problem of humanity. And here is that problem. It's sin. Now, in Paul's day, and I would argue that even in our modern day, sin is not a popular topic. In fact, the fastest growing churches in our culture today are churches that don't really talk about sin. We want to focus on more positive messages and be uplifting, and we don't want to bring the party down, so we don't address sin. But friends, if we're going to take the Bible seriously, then we must deal with this issue of sin, and more particularly, the issue of the wrath of God. In Romans chapter 1, verse 18, Paul tells us that the wrath of God is being revealed against all unrighteousness. God is a holy and just God, and a holy and just God cannot and will not tolerate sin and rebellion. So because of sin, God's righteous wrath is over all of humanity. This is humanity's problem, and all of us find ourselves having to wrestle with this and deal with this. So after explaining the wrath of God, Paul is going to go to great lengths over the course of chapter 2 and 3 to make sure everybody understands there are no exemptions to this. You are included in this wrath. I always say that it's like, do you remember when Oprah was like, you get a car, you get a car? Paul's like, you're under God's wrath, you're under God's wrath, you're a sinner, you're a sinner. None of you get out of this. If you are a human, you are under the wrath of God because of sin. We're really good at amening when we talk about those people who are under God's wrath, right? I love talking about those people, but then when it gets pointed to me, I get a little bit nervous. Chapter 2, Paul says those who claim to not know anything of God or His wrath, who say, well, we wouldn't even know about this, they are without excuse. And I love that he anticipates the Jewish audience saying, yeah, those godless heathens, God's wrath is being revealed on them. Because then he turns it to them. He says, man, your religious background is not going to save you from the wrath of God. And here in chapter 3, in case anybody was feeling righteous, Paul is going to essentially just quote verse Psalm 14 and Psalm 53. I want you to read this with me if you have your Bible open still. Look at verse 10 of chapter 3. Let's just read this quotation together. None is righteous, no, not one. No one understands. No one seeks for God. All have turned aside. Together, they have become worthless. No one does good, not even one. Their throat is an open grave. They use their tongues to deceive. The venom of asps is under their lips. Their mouth is full of curses and bitterness. Their feet are swift to shed blood. In their paths are ruin and misery. And the way of peace they have not known. There is no fear of God before their eyes. Friends, it is abundantly clear humanity has a sin problem. And because humanity has a sin problem, we are under the wrath of God. We are an unrighteous people under the righteous wrath of a holy God. So what are we to do? If God is holy and righteous and you and I are not, how can we find ourselves in right standing with this God? So for most of human history, what we've tried to do is fix ourselves, whether it be through sacrifices, religious performance, or our own efforts. We just try to be good people. We try to be holy and righteous enough that we can stand before a holy and righteous God. But no matter how hard we try, we cannot do it. And here's the wild part. Even if you start to think, actually, I'm kind of killing it right now. Congratulations, you've just discovered the sin of pride, which essentially is the root of all of our sins, isn't it? So we find ourselves once again in this same unrighteous position. So the problem with humanity is that we are unable to produce righteousness within ourselves, and therefore we are sinners under the righteous wrath of a holy and perfect God. So thank y'all for having me. I hope you... No, I'm kidding. If that was the end, we would not call this Good Friday. Some of you are thinking, send this dude back to Buna. Where did Randy find this guy? And you may be thinking, why are we talking about this on Good Friday? But here's what I need you to understand tonight, what I think the Lord wants us to understand. If you don't understand the wrath of God, if you don't understand how much God hates sin, then you will not understand the depths of the love of Christ. The radical lengths that he went for our salvation. If you've never pondered the wrath of God, then I think your understanding of the cross and your understanding of the gospel is kind of like seeing it in black and white. And I hope that tonight, as we look at this text, that you will perhaps see the gospel and the beauty of the cross on display in full color for the first time. And when I wrote that earlier today, I wasn't thinking about looking up at this beautiful cross in full color that's above me here. Y'all aren't seeing it, but it's awesome. I love y'all's church building, by the way. Let me get back to the text. I think that this passage we're studying is the key to understanding how the wrath of God and the love of God come together on this Good Friday. In verse 21, Paul says, "But now the righteousness of God has been manifested apart from the law." That word manifested simply means revealed or shown. God has shown us a way to be righteous outside of ourselves. Oh, friends, listen to me. The answer to humanity's problem does not lie within us. Regardless of what Disney movie you watched, or kids movie, or kids fairy tale book, or whatever the world is telling you today, the answer to humanity's problem doesn't lie deep within. It's interesting to me that even secular culture is aware of humanity's problem. Now, secular culture would not diagnose humanity's problem as sin. But the world out there recognizes that we are not well, that all is not well with us. The answer of our modern therapeutic culture is to look deep inside yourself. Sort out what's going on the inside. Get the right view of yourself and you can fix your life. But the reality is, friends, this is just another form of works-based religion. Whether the works you're trying to do are pop psychology or whether it's religious effort, the Bible makes it clear you cannot fix yourself. You will not be able to manifest your own righteousness. But praise be to God, His righteousness has been revealed, manifested apart from our own striving. How has it been revealed? Verse 22 says it this way, the righteousness of God through faith in Jesus Christ for all who believe. Oh, church, the way we experience the righteousness of God is by placing our faith in Christ Jesus. And in verse 23, Paul essentially summarizes what he said in the first three chapters. All have sinned and fall short of the glory of God. Everyone. But we've moved from explaining the problem of humanity now to explain the redemption of humanity in verse 24. The text says, and are justified by His grace as a gift through the redemption that is in Christ Jesus. We are justified, or we are made righteous, not through our works, but the gift of redemption that is in Christ Jesus. It's this gift of redemption that we celebrate this weekend. The death, burial, and resurrection of Jesus Christ. And this text gives us so much detail. It really does answer the question for us, why the cross? Verse 25 is going to tell us how this redemption was accomplished. It says that God put forward Jesus as a propitiation by His blood to be received by faith. This word propitiation has kind of been a theological powder keg in recent history. There are some who, in this modern theological world, would advocate against the idea of Jesus being our substitutionary atonement. But without the cross, without the substitutionary atonement, you need to know something, friends. We are not saved. This is the gospel. If you've never heard that term, let me just simply say this is what it means. It's the idea that Jesus died on the cross, literally, as our substitute. He took our place, and as Jesus hung on the cross, the wrath of God that you and I deserve was poured out on Him. The punishment we deserve because all of our sin, past, present, and future, was poured out on Christ. His death is the death that you and I deserve to die. The text literally says, by His blood, our sins have been covered. And now don't underestimate the last line of that sentence, to be received by faith. So friends, here is the good news of the gospel. For those who recognize that sinners far from God, for those who recognize that they can't fix their own life, but for those who believe that Jesus died on the cross to pay the price for their sins, and those who come to Him and place their faith in Him and repent and believe, in that moment, Jesus' death becomes their death. But what we're going to celebrate in a couple of days is the glorious reality that Jesus didn't stay dead. And the glory of the gospel is that not only does Jesus' death become our death, but His life becomes our new life. This is what theologians would call double imputation. You didn't know we were going to get all theological. You got a boy from Buna up here to go theology on you. Dr. Redke is way smarter than me in these regards, but that's all right. Double imputation. Here's what that means. When Jesus died on the cross, the payment for sin was imputed or given to you and me. So when you come to Christ, our sins are forgiven. Now, let me just say, that in and of itself is absolutely amazing, is it not? We could sing Amazing Grace, how sweet the sound. We could say, what mercy the Lord has had. We sang it earlier, Jesus paid it all. Praise God, our debt has been paid. We have a clean slate. If I could go like Catholic priest on you and wave my hand and make all your sins go away right here in this moment, it would be awesome. But here's the problem, if we could just level with one another real quick. Before you get home tonight, you're going to mess up that clean slate. Some of you, before we're done with service, you're going to be like, this is taking too long. Double imputation means this: not only have we been given payment for our sins because of Christ, His death becomes our death, but also His new life, His righteousness, is applied to us. So here's what that means, friends. The righteousness of God, the righteousness of Christ, becomes your righteousness. This is the beauty of the gospel. Though we are sinners and rebels, though we are deserving of the wrath of God, Jesus became our propitiation. That's another theological word that's so beautiful. It just simply means this, that Jesus fully satisfied the wrath of God. When you come to the cross, when you come to Christ, you are no longer under His wrath. When God looks at you, He doesn't see you as a sinner. He doesn't see your guilt and your shame. He sees you as perfect and holy, because when He looks at you, He sees Jesus. So when we are saved, we are redeemed, we finally get to experience the perfect relationship with our perfect and holy God that we were created to have. That's when life really begins. The God who created us to worship Him and enjoy Him forever, our life starts. And all of this is possible because of the cross of Christ. I've always loved verse 26. And this is so beautiful, as this entire passage is. But this verse is really why the Lord led me to this text tonight. I want you to look at it with me. Here's what verse 26 says. It was to show His righteousness at the present time, so that He might be just and the justifier of the one who has faith in Jesus. I believe that this verse right here explains to us how the wrath of God and the love of God intersect at the cross of Christ. This holy and righteous God must in if He is to be perfect and holy. This is what a just God does. This just God is also a God of love, and His love led Jesus to the cross, where this just God also becomes the justifying God. Isn't that beautiful? So the call tonight is to place your faith in Christ Jesus. Don't trust in your works. Don't look deep inside yourself for the problem of humanity. The only way we can find the righteousness of God and thus a relationship with God is to look outside of ourselves to the cross of Christ that we're remembering tonight. And I know that you guys are like varsity squad Christians because you came on a Friday night. But I do not want to assume that everybody in here knows Jesus as their personal Lord and Savior. If you do not know Jesus today, do not leave this place. Talk to your pastor. Talk to somebody. Say, man, I want to know what it means to know Jesus. But even for those who are saved, who know Jesus and have placed their faith in Him, today is a day to remember and reflect and to renew our commitments to Christ and His gospel. I would encourage you maybe to read the next paragraph later this evening, but essentially Paul says this: if you're saved, you don't have anything to brag about outside of Christ and His cross. I mean, isn't that what we're here to do tonight? Is essentially to boast in the cross of Christ. That we have been saved, not because of our works, not because of our effort, but the righteousness of God has been manifested outside of us by the work of Jesus Christ, His death, burial, and resurrection. And because of that, our sins have been paid, and we have been given new life, and we get to live life with the God who created us to worship and enjoy Him forever. So may we be a church and be a people and be families and individuals who boast in the cross of Christ. Lord, we love You. We thank You for this word. Thank You for this letter that Paul wrote. God, thank You for the cross, where the wrath of God was satisfied by the love of Christ that came and took our place. May we be mindful of that. Lord, I pray that if anybody in here doesn't know you, that today would be the day of salvation. God, I pray for those who do know you, that today would be a day they remember the gospel in a way that deepens their commitment to you. May we always boast in the cross of Christ. It's in your name we pray. Amen.
Thank you. But at Calvary,
we're gonna sing the last verse.
Oh, the love that drew salvation's plan. Oh, the love that brought it down to man. Oh, the mighty gulf that God did span at Calvary. Mercy there was great and grace was free. Pardon there was multiplied to me. There my burdened soul found liberty at Calvary.